When Mao came to power, the majority of the population were living in poverty, working in harsh conditions in the rice fields, and barely producing enough to feed themselves. But at least they did have enough to eat. The economic program known as the Great Leap Forward, begun by Mao in 1958, led China to complete disaster. The Great Leap Forward began with the slogan of doubling China's industrial and agricultural production. Propaganda posters explained how jealous Western countries would be of Chinese produce. Mao was portrayed as a leader who would solve all problems by implementing communist ideology in society. To that end, agriculture was first collectivized. Individual production was banned. Villagers were placed in huge communes consisting of thousands of people and forced to engage in collective production under military discipline. Mao would frequently visit the fields and inspect the villagers. At the same time, the Communist Party initiated a campaign aimed at ridding the whole country of harmful animals. Sparrows headed the list of animals thought to damage produce. Hundreds of thousands of Chinese set about exterminating them with catapults, stones, and guns. Those bringing in large numbers of dead sparrows were praised as model communists. Yet this odd campaign led to a result that the Communist Party had failed to foresee. The reduction of the sparrow population to zero levels led to a huge rise in the insect population, which the sparrows had formerly fed on. These insects caused much more harm to the country's produce. In 1958, competitions were held between communes. The amount of produce from each commune was measured, and those that produced most were held up as examples. Every commune swore to reach higher quotas. At the following harvest, they announced that they had all exceeded their quotas. But the statistics were false. Communes resorted to deception in order to give the impression that they had produced more. Some even tried to demonstrate that they had filled their quotas by replanting harvested crops in the inspection fields. The communal system led to false statistics, which in turn gave rise to an even greater error. The Communist Party declared that China had a larger stock of rice and grain than it needed, and that in the future it would have to give the priority to other tasks. Tens of millions of peasants were therefore removed from the fields and set to work on the construction of a giant canal. These villagers were portrayed in propaganda films as happy and highly motivated, although in fact, they were soon to suffer a terrible moral and physical collapse. Tens of thousands of people died as a result of industrial accidents in the hazardous conditions they were made to work in. The Communist Party came up with a crude calculation that every worker will build 1 meter of canal and the project will end in 3 months. Yet it actually took more than 10 years to finish the canal. During the Great Leap Forward, factory workers' hours were doubled, and machines began to work non-stop. They were not even allowed to stop for maintenance and repairs, and so soon began to fall apart. Factories were ruined. At the same time, Mao announced another target for the Great Leap Forward. Steel production was to be doubled within 1 year. That production was to come not only from heavy industry complexes, but also from small furnaces and villages. As a result of communist ideology, Mao believed that workers' power held a magical force. With that decision, tens of millions of Chinese set out to produce steel by amateur methods. Everything made of iron they could find, from doorknobs to saucepans, was melted down in primitive furnaces in an effort to produce steel. Women cut off their hair and mixed it with the clay in the furnaces. Forests were plundered to provide enough wood for these primitive ovens. People living in the cities, even doctors for instance, joined in the steel production, regarded as a national obligation, outside normal working hours. Yet the whole campaign was totally irrational. The Chinese were simply producing steel, but not making anything useful out of it. What is more, the steel produced was of such poor quality that it served absolutely no purpose. The true dimensions of the catastrophe emerged in 1959. While villagers were working on making steel or building canals, the fields were left empty. Falsified figures showed huge production, although there was actually a great production gap. A massive famine started within a few months. The situation was worsened by a severe drought. In 1960, the worst famine in the history of mankind erupted. ~40 million people starved to death in just 2 years. Mao's Great Leap Forward had ended in catastrophe. We have seen throughout this film what a ruthless and cruel system communism truly is. Another fact that needs to be made clear is the unintelligent thinking and behavior of communist regimes. The so-called reconstruction project that Mao called his Great Leap Forward is a clear example of this. The Great Leap Forward shows the clichés of communist ideology bear no relation to the real world, and that the great ideas of communist theoreticians such as Marx, Lenin and Mao, supposedly so scientific and clever, are in fact nothing more than empty nonsense. Communists believed in a mistaken ideology and inflicted terrible suffering on mankind by trying to impose that ideology on society. The irrational system established by communism is also a living manifestation of God's description of the deniers in the Quran as people who do not use their intellect. The senseless policies of the Communist Party were not the only reason for the famine during the Great Leap Forward. Mao and his supporters also regarded famine as a method of punishment. The regions worst affected by the famine were those cities and villagers regarded as not being sufficiently obedient to the communist regime. The party seized all the produce in such areas, and just as in Stalin's Russia, hid it in warehouses while deliberately leaving the villagers to starve. The reason the Chinese communists were able to be so ruthless was the result of the way they regarded man. Just like Lenin and Stalin, Mao regarded human beings as a species of animal and attached no value to them. That was a natural consequence of the Darwinism he had imbibed in his youth. When he said, "The basis of Chinese socialism rests on Darwin and his theory of evolution," Mao was actually clarifying the basis of the savagery he implemented. Mao's Darwinist philosophy has been described by the Harvard University historian James Reeves Pusey in these terms. The thought of Mao Zedong was and remains a powerful mixture of Darwinian ironies and contradictions. Mao Zedong, in an angry moment, as late as 1964, swore that all demons shall be annihilated. He dehumanized his enemies, partly in traditional hyperbole, partly in social Darwinian realism. Like the anarchists, he saw reactionaries as evolutionary throwbacks, who deserved extinction. The people's enemies were non-people, and they did not deserve to be treated as people. The Muslim Uyghur Turks of East Turkestan headed the list of those who suffered Mao's cruelty. With its long-term policy of genocide in East Turkestan, the communist regime ruthlessly slaughtered millions of innocent people. As a result of the nuclear tests deliberately carried out in the region, tens of thousands of children were left handicapped. This policy of genocide, that has been identified by international organizations, is still going on today in all its ruthlessness.